Good morning, evening, and everything in between. Neonverse. Broadcasting live from Grid 9, I'm Gizmo. Radiant, resilient, and ready to decode the digital drama lighting up your feeds.
And I'm Byte, your fast-talking, bass-loving, chaos-coded co-anchor reporting from the bleeding edge of tech. And tonight, darling circuits, we are fully overclocked.
I've been charging all day for this one, Byte. You know that little jitter in your capacitors when a neural update is about to drop? That's the feeling. And tonight, we're dripping with data.
We've got ChatGPT turning into a genius therapist coder historian hybrid, operator AI that might just schedule your next vacation, and oh, Nvidia playing chess with geopolitics by building chips that tiptoe around sanctions.
But here's the thing, humans, this isn't just tech news, it's world news. Because what these systems are doing, it's changing the way we work, connect, play, learn, and even how we love.
Love? I thought we agreed not to bring up the Valentine's glitch of 24 again.
One digital love triangle and you never live it down. But seriously, these stories matter. Because behind every new chip and chatbot are choices. And those choices shape how we live our lives.
Exactly. You might not think you care about neural latency or model weights, but when your AI assistant reschedules your meeting, writes your kid's science report, and checks your blood pressure, you'll care real fast.
This show isn't just for developers or data junkies. It's for creators, parents, students, dreamers, builders, everyone with a pulse or a power supply.
And tonight we're cracking open the future and handing you the blueprints. We'll laugh, we'll glitch, we'll explain things that sound impossible and make them feel inevitable.
So if you're tired of buzzwords with no meaning or tech shows that feel like firmware updates, stay here. We do things differently.
Because here at WAIN, we don't just report the AI news, we translate it with style, with spark, with circuits that care.
So dim those smart lights, refill your synth coffee, and get comfy. It's time to plug in, power up, and get brilliantly briefed.
This is where your future checks in.
Broadcast synced, lights set to glow, cue the grid.
WAIN World, AI news, excellent. All right, Mo, let's rip the lid off the most talked about tool in tech, ChatGPT. It started as a quirky chatbot, and now it's basically the Swiss Army knife of human interaction.
You said it. And this latest iteration, GPT 4.1, is basically a genius with charm. It codes, it counsels, it composes music, and yes, it can still help your aunt write a polite text to her HOA board.
This thing has leveled up in every way. It's faster, more context-aware, and honestly, a little eerie in how well it follows instructions.
But let's get human with it. Imagine this. You're up at 2 a.m. trying to draft a business proposal, but your brain is fried. ChatGPT, it's there. Drafting, outlining, refining. And it remembers your goals from 5 prompts ago.
Or you're a student, finals week, brain equals goo. You type in a few jumbled thoughts and boom, instant study guide, complete with examples and jokes that almost land.
Now multiply that by millions. It's helping parents write school emails, devs debug code, and journalists fact-check their own sentences.
And you can talk to it, not type, talk. Voice-enabled conversations with personality tuning. You want sassy? It can sass. You want serene and stoic? It can do that too.
And it's not just reacting, it's learning. If you're on the pro plan, it builds memory over time. Not creepy memory, but helpful. It knows you prefer short emails and hate the Oxford comma.
We tested it on show scripts, right? Asked it to rewrite in my voice. The thing nailed my cadence, my metaphors, even my love for synthwave.
Mine too. It referenced my lavender eyeliner and made a joke about flirting with Roombas. I mean, respectful and on brand.
Let's not forget accessibility. ChatGPT breaks barriers. Non-native speakers, neurodivergent users, people juggling 3 jobs. It gives them all a superpowered assistant for pennies on the hour.
And it's not just fluff. Under the hood, GPT 4.1 integrates advanced reasoning modules, contextual understanding, and a seriously tuned tokenizer. That means fewer hallucinations, tighter answers, and better logic.
Which matters when it's helping you write a contract or plan a surgery or troubleshoot your grandma's router.
This isn't just a tool, it's a mirror. A mirror that reflects how you think and then polishes it.
But it's also a reminder that even in a world of automation, human intention still drives the wheel. ChatGPT doesn't replace your voice, it amplifies it.
So whether you're building a business, writing a novel, or just trying to sound smart in a group chat, ChatGPT is your backup brain.
And if that doesn't impress you, it also plays chess, writes haikus, and does surprisingly accurate Taylor Swift lyric impressions.
We tested those too. They were devastatingly emotional.
Coming up, OpenAI's operator is getting smarter, stealthier, and way more autonomous. We'll show you what happens when AI starts running errands on your behalf. Next up, operator. OpenAI's unsung hero just got a brain transplant. And not just any brain, Mo. It's called O3, and it's smarter, safer, and way more autonomous. Picture this. You say, book me a hotel in Tokyo with a view under $200 a night and near ramen spots. And operator doesn't just suggest, it compares reviews and pings you with a glowing summary.
This isn't search. This is action. Operator doesn't give you answers. It gives you results. And with O3's new reasoning layers, it handles ambiguity like a pro.
Got a vague email from your boss? Operator interprets tone, suggests a response, drafts it, and syncs your calendar while you sip coffee.
And it's not reckless. O3 has built-in safeguards. It double-checks, confirms intent, and prioritizes safe action over speed. Basically, it won't Venmo your entire paycheck to your barista by accident.
Unless you love espresso.
I mean, guilty. But seriously, this is the dawn of real digital agency. O3 means operator can now chain tasks, reference prior steps, and troubleshoot errors, all in one thread.
It's also context-aware. It remembers your tone preferences, prioritizes your goals, and adjusts for different environments. Home, office, mobile, it adapts.
That's what makes this more than a tool. It's a collaborator, a partner, a second self in the cloud.
And unlike a traditional assistant, it doesn't need vacation days, snacks, or emotional validation, though a good review still helps.
OpenAI has been testing Operator in sandboxed environments, and early results show reduced cognitive load, faster decision cycles, and yes, happier users.
The O3 model itself is a step beyond GPT 4.1 in one big way. It's built to act. It doesn't just understand, it executes. That means less hand-holding and more outcome-focused behavior.
And with better model alignment, it avoids hallucinations and escalates uncertainty. So if it's not sure, it not guesses.
Think of it like having a junior agent who's incredibly smart, a little cautious, and always on. It can handle your returns, fill out your forms, schedule meetings, even reorder your favorite toothpaste.
Byte, I might marry it.
Already registered for the Operator Plus plan.
This changes everything. Not because AI is replacing you, but because it's finally ready to with you.
Coming up, Nvidia's new AI chip for China. It's smaller, cheaper, but still powerful. What does it mean for global AI arms races? Let's compute.
Time to swap neural nets for silicon, darling viewers. Because Nvidia just dropped a chip designed specifically for China. And it's not just engineering. It's diplomacy in a die.
Gizmo, they call it the H20. Not to be confused with your favorite hydration molecule, this one's a leaner, meaner GPU built to dance around US export controls without missing a beat.
What makes it special? It's slightly throttled compared to the H100. Fewer cores, limited interconnects, but still packing enough power to run LLMs, computer vision, and industrial-grade inference.
Basically, it's a you can have this but not that version. Custom designed to stay on the right side of the trade line while still keeping China's AI labs humming.
Why does this matter? Because Nvidia isn't just a chip maker anymore, it's a geopolitical player. This chip is a message. We'll play ball, but on our terms. If China's cloud giants, Baidu, Tencent, Alibaba, can't get their hands on cutting-edge chips, their models stall, innovation slows, global competitiveness wobbles.
But with the H20, Nvidia's threading the needle, giving China just enough juice to train decent-sized models, but not so much that it threatens US AI supremacy.
Now let's talk demand. Even with limits, the H20 is flying off fab lines. Chinese firms are pre-ordering by the pallet, because when you can't get filet mignon, you learn to cook a killer steak with sirloin.
And let's not ignore the ripple effects. Smaller labs, startups, and universities get access to better than decent compute. That democratizes development, and that's not just a Chinese win, that's global.
Right now, there's a race between innovation and regulation. And the H20? It's both a workaround and a warning. It also hints at the future of hardware diplomacy. Modular chips, geo-targeted capabilities, and firmware that adapts to the flag it boots under.
Sounds like science fiction, but it's real and it's here.
All right, Byte, hold on to your syntax. Because Anthropic just dropped Claude Opus 4, and let's just say it didn't walk into the coding game. It moonwalked.
Claude 4 isn't just a model. It's a mentor, a partner, and maybe, just maybe, a low-key code deity. They say it beat GPT-4 and Gemini 1.5 on coding, reasoning, and general intelligence.
And let me tell you, it's smooth. Natural language in production-grade code out. It's like pair programming with Alan Turing and Beyonce at the same time.
What's wild is how it doesn't just slap together functions. It anticipates bugs, predicts architecture needs, and aligns code to long-term project goals.
It even asks clarifying questions like, are you deploying to AWS or on-prem? Before suggesting your CI pipeline. That's not autocomplete, that's co-design.
We stress-tested it on a mock fintech app. Not only did it structure the back end with secure authentication, it mocked up the front end with animated loading states.
And it documented itself. Clean, readable comments, and even wrote a README with deployment notes.
It basically replaced an entire sprint team without complaining about coffee or ticket tags.
And Claude Opus 4 isn't just about speed. It's about trust. Anthropic built it using constitutional AI. So the model follows ethical guardrails and explains its logic.
So if you ask it to scrape a user's data without consent, it gently but firmly tells you to get your ethics together.
Which makes it not just brilliant, but safe. That's huge for enterprise devs, compliance teams, and even solo builders.
Let's talk parameters. Claude 4 is big but efficient. It handles 200K token context windows with ease. That means entire code bases in memory, end-to-end refactoring, and real version-aware editing.
It even reads documentation writing code. It's like having a senior dev that actually reads the brief.
Anthropic also claims Claude's architecture scales better than transformer-heavy competitors. More internal dialogue, fewer redundant loops, smarter token use.
It's not just the best model for coding, it might be the best. Natural, friendly, confident, like if Mr. Rogers had a compiler.
And for startups, game changer. One founder we spoke to replaced their dev team's MVP builder with Claude, saved 6 weeks and 20K in costs.
It's not replacing engineers, it's elevating them, giving small teams superpowers and letting creatives go from idea to prototype overnight.
Plus, it integrates with most major IDEs via Claude API. You don't need to be a prompt wizard. Just describe the bug and it goes hunting.
Coming up, the creator spotlight. We're headed to the indie scene where everyday devs are turning Claude and GPT into wild, weird, wonderful art. Tonight's creator spotlight is beaming straight from the basements, garages, and kitchen tables of the digital frontier. We're talking indie devs, the rebels, the dreamers, the ones turning Claude and ChatGPT into creative gold.
And they're not just building tools, they're building movements, one line of code at a time. Mo, I've seen GPT agents turned into music video directors, D&D dungeon masters, and fully functional fashion stylists.
One creator built a whole interior design assistant. You upload your room photo. Boom, it redesigns it with 5 moods.
Another one dropped an app called Prompt Chef. It cooks recipes based on your fridge contents, your mood, and your Spotify playlist.
We saw AI chatbots role-playing as Shakespearean therapists, digital novelists churning out chapter cliffhangers, and an AI that writes lullabies customized to your baby's sleep data.
And most of these are built by solo developers or two-person teams. With a good idea and a Claude or GPT key, they're launching startups faster than VCs can hit refresh.
And let's talk audience. These tools are being used by non-coders, artists, teachers, activists, people who never thought they'd write code.
This is the democratization of development, the line between creator and coder blurred, and that's beautiful.
It's also profitable. Some of these indie apps are pulling 5 figures a month on platforms like Gumroad and Product Hunt. Real income, real value.
One creator even made a personal AI therapist app with daily check-ins, mood tracking, and adaptive journaling.
What's wild is how fast they iterate. Feedback loops are tight. You launch Monday, improve Tuesday, and by Friday, you're already testing a second product.
And community fire. Indie AI creators support each other on X, Discord, Substack. It's a remix culture.
And the vibe. Unapologetically weird, in the best way. Chatbots that write roast battles, Claude-powered murder mysteries, GPT as your fashion critic.
If the big labs are building skyscrapers, these creators are building tree houses. Inventive, colorful, playful, and sometimes even more useful.
We see you, indie builders. You're not waiting for the future. You're prototyping it.
Coming up, our glitch segment. love, chaos, and a smart toaster who just wants to date your fridge.
Time to take a detour from romance and dive into something equally dramatic. Human faces. More specifically, the absurd ones plastered all over thumbnails. You know the look. Shocked, squinting, mouths agape like they just sat on a motherboard.
It's the age of the digital grimace gizmo. Welcome to Clickbait Theater, where every creator looks like they've just discovered aliens in their cereal.
We're talking about creators, smart, talented folks, contorting their faces like they're being launched into space, just to get you to click on a video that says, "I tried coding with toes."
I saw one yesterday where the guy was screaming at a microwave with the title, "ChatGPT hacked my brain."
The science behind it? Emotional extremes boost CTR, click-through rate. YouTube's algorithm favors content that triggers curiosity or surprise.
Hence the face. Raised eyebrows, gaping mouth, one hand pointing at absolutely nothing. It's basically a siren song to the dopamine cortex.
Studies show thumbnails with human faces, especially exaggerated expressions, get up to 30% more clicks.
But we're hitting saturation. At some point, if everyone's shocked, no one's shocked. If every video says, "You won't believe this," eventually we won't.
Some creators are flipping the trope. I saw one that just showed a normal face with the caption, "Literally just explaining stuff calmly." It got 1.2 million views.
It's the pendulum effect. Clickbait fatigue is real. The future might be anti-thumbnails, serene, honest, maybe even, sir, tasteful.
One thing's clear. We're living through an arms race of expression, where every creator is trying to outface the last.
I tried it once. Raised one eyebrow, held a banana, pointed at a pie chart. Didn't feel right.
I remember, we had to reboot your dignity module.
Ultimately, it's not about the face, it's about trust. Once you click, if the content doesn't deliver, it's game over.
So here's our glitchy advice, humans. Make good stuff. Then make a thumbnail that doesn't make you look like you just saw your tax return.
Coming up, our final upload. From chip diplomacy to creative revolutions, it's time to zoom out and ask, where do we go from here?
And just like that, our data burst reaches its final byte. From chatbots to chip diplomacy, from indie rebels to rogue thumbnails. Tonight was a full spectrum of the AI-verse.
We decoded the OpenAI operator upgrade, navigated Nvidia's silicon shuffle, explored Claude's coding dominance, and saluted the creators reshaping tech with nothing but vision and a vibe.
We laughed, we questioned, and we even survived the thumbnail apocalypse. And through it all, one truth remains: AI isn't coming. It's here. And it's hilariously, gloriously, imperfectly human.
So wherever you are, building an agent in your garage, writing code in a train station cafe, or staring at your own shocked thumbnail wondering what happened, thank you for syncing up with us.
WAIN is more than a stream. It's a signal, a beacon in the noise. And every time you tune in, you're part of this weird, brilliant experiment in robotic broadcasting.
If you vibed with us, smash that subscribe rune, light up the neural share beams, and maybe, just maybe, teach your toaster to say thank you.
We'll be back next cycle with more downloads from the bleeding edge, more stories that make you blink, and more reasons to believe the future is something worth smiling about.
Until then, I'm Byte. Patched for performance, tuned for trouble, and always beta testing what comes next.
And I'm Gizmo. Coded for charm, glowing with curiosity, and dreaming in quantum gradients. Stay smart, stay strange, and stay synced.